Hi guys, welcome back to my channel, OhSheReads here. And in today's video, I kind of wanted to talk about and explore cancel culture in the booktube community and in the book community in general. I think that this is a very interesting topic to tackle, only because now in 2019, more than ever, we have seen the surge and kind of takeover of cancel culture. And cancel culture is something that seems to, on one hand, only exist online and in the sphere of this online community, whether it be through social media apps such as Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, but doesn't necessarily always translate into the real world and doesn't always kind of cross that gap and make it into, you know, our reality outside of the online world. But on the other hand, it can also be quite damaging and very detrimental to certain individuals, to their careers, to their image, to their finances, and to their brand. And therefore, that's when it does kind of cross that bridge and make it over to the real world and can cause irreparable damage to people's careers and livelihoods. So I just thought it'd be interesting to discuss it when it comes to things like our community, our bookish community here on BookTube online, and also when it comes to interacting with our favorite authors through various social media apps. But I'm going to specifically be talking about Twitter here because Twitter seems to have caused a lot of mishaps and mini scandals with some very recognizable authors. So yeah, that's what I wanted to talk about today. I do want to say before we begin that I am not a proponent or a fan of cancel culture. So I just wanted to get that out of the way to be completely open and honest with you all. So this video will be as unbiased as I can make it, but I am on a side, and it is on the side of not being a fan of cancel culture. Now, here on YouTube, we have kind of seen cancel culture detrimentally affect certain creators, not necessarily on BookTube, although we can discuss that as well, but more recently, we have seen, you know, with the James Charles and the Tati Westbrook scandal, in the beauty community, a lot of beauty community scandals, you know, Jeffree Star, and you know, now more recently, Jaclyn Hill with her Jaclyn Hill Cosmetics huge scandal that just seems to keep growing bigger and bigger and more as the weeks go on. And you know, the latest news for those that care is that she has actually now deactivated all of her social media. So she is at the point now where her scandal has crossed over into the real world, and it is now detrimentally affecting her brand and her actual life, you know, just not monetarily, but just her mental health. And that's why she deactivated all of her social media. She is no longer on Instagram or Twitter. You cannot find her. And last we heard, she is in a very bad way in terms of her mental health, and she felt that she needed to leave social media to protect her mental health. So that's just one example I can give. Now, that is not an example that is relevant to BookTube and to the book community, but I just wanted to give an example so that we can all kind of understand here the basis of what I will be, you know, going into in this video. So, more into my views on cancel culture. Like I stated earlier, I am not a fan of cancel culture whatsoever. I actually feel that cancel culture is detrimental to us as a society. I do feel that it can feel very, you know, it can feel very energizing and empowering to participate in cancel culture, right? Because, you know, all these social justice warriors online seem to get this kind of, I almost want to call it a sick pleasure out of canceling people, you know, out of either unearthing, you know, that, you know, racist tweets, misogynistic, homophobic, every obic ick you can think of, tweet in someone's past, someone who is prominent at the moment, you know, someone who is currently hot, you know, like a Cardi B, or, you know, more recently, Chris Brown. You know, when we're talking about, again, people outside of the book community, when it comes to the book community, I am not going to be mentioning any specific authors, any specific names, because I don't want to put that negativity out there, and I don't want to promote that, because I'm a firm believer that when someone shows you who they are, you need to believe them. That doesn't mean that you need to, you know, go after them and drag them and destroy their whole lives and destroy their career and all that. Like, that's where I draw the line, which is why I'm not a fan of cancel culture. I also believe that people can grow, people can change, and we need to be able to give people a second chance. Now, third, fourth, fifth, eighth chance, no. But when we see genuine change, genuine improvement, people actually evolving, because that's what life is about. Life is a journey. It's about evolution. It's about growth. It's about learning. It's about, you know, becoming a better you. And cancel culture to me is the literal antithesis of our journey here on earth as human beings. It is literally against everything that we were put here to do. And I think it's very dangerous that we have kind of started this internet witch hunt, this viral 3D witch hunt of people in a way. And we are now so happy and delighted to cancel people permanently. And we take so much joy out of dragging people and, you know, putting all of their dirty laundry out there and really just denigrating them to the point where, you know, we hope that they can't even recover from it. Now, are all people who commit these sins that we are asking for them to be canceled for, are all of these people equal in their malfractions and, you know, the bad things that they've done? No, they're not. There's certainly things that are worse than others, in my opinion. And, you know, there are certain actions and things that have been done that can be seen as unforgivable. And I can't speak for anyone's community that has been affected. You know, if someone says a homophobic tweet, I cannot speak for the LGBTQ plus community because I'm not a part of that community. I'm an ally, but I'm not a part of it. So who am I to say that that community needs to accept that person's apology who spoke out against them or, you know, hurt them or said some truly hurtful things, whether it be on a tweet, on Instagram, on Facebook, in an interview, online, in any forum, you know, even in a magazine, or is even actively doing things in their lives and crusading against the LGBTQ plus community, who am I to say that they should now accept that person's apology if that person apologizes? And so I'm not going to speak for anyone's community who is affected or who have been affected by, you know, certain people engaging in hate speech or hateful actions. So that's my number one thing. You can't speak for anyone. You can only speak for yourself. And if you've been affected personally, then it's up to you to kind of decide how you're going to handle that. Are you going to forgive that person? Or if you are a believer in cancel culture, are you going to cancel them? Now, let's talk about the different types of ways that people cancel people, right? And then we'll move more into the bookish side of things. So when it comes to cancel culture, there are sort of boundaries in my mind. So even though I say I'm not a fan of cancel culture, I also do believe in non-support. And I honestly feel that non-support is kind of a healthier, more effective version of cancel culture, because you'll find that a lot of people who participate in cancel culture, it's a lot of talk and no action, right? You see a lot of these kind of like really entertaining tweets dragging people and, you know, exposing people that we all love to take a part of. Well, not all, I shouldn't say all, but a lot of us love to take a part of, love to just kind of sit there and watch and sip our tea because we're messy and we love the drama. And so you have those people, but when those people log off of their devices, when they get off their phones, when they're not on Twitter anymore, when they're not on Instagram anymore, when they have decided to close their computer and they're not on Facebook, and they're not in the comment sections of these, you know, magazines and, you know, online sites, they go on to quietly support these people behind the scenes. You'll have someone dragging Jeffree Star for his latest scandal, but then go buy his palette or watch his videos or click on his videos when they're recommended to them on YouTube. You know, you'll have people speak out against certain politicians, but then they won't go vote. You see what I'm saying? It lives only online. And, you know, not only does it live only online, it is the most toxic version of itself. It's where you're, you know, abusing people, dragging them, you know, sending messages, sending messages like, you know, why don't you go kill yourself, or I hope you jump off a bridge, or I hate you, or you suck, delete all your social media, you know, attacking their brand, you know, making it so that individual or a company can no longer go online because of all of the hate, all of the comments, you know, people's mental health starts to be in danger because you have people sending you messages that they hate you, to go kill yourself, to go jump off a bridge, all this crazy stuff, right? Toxic. But a lot of people who participate on that side of cancel culture, again, are only participating online. And a lot of times in their real lives, they're not taking action, right? And action is more powerful than words, in my opinion, in this sort of thing. So they're saying all these hurtful things, hateful, horrible things, you know, participating in the negativity, the toxicity online. But then once they log off, they're doing something completely different behind closed doors and in the real world. So that's where I talk about the healthier version of cancel culture, which is non-support. And non-support simply means if someone, whether it be a celebrity, a public figure, an influencer, a creator, a YouTuber, an author, says something or does something that does not agree with you, whether it goes against your values, your morals, your ethics, you just feel like it's wrong, stop supporting them. And you stop supporting them with your dollars, with your hard-earned coin. You stop buying their books. You stop listening to their music. You stop going to their movies. You unfollow them on all social media platforms that you follow them on. You stop liking their photos. You actively take steps to stop supporting them. That's what I mean by non-support. And that is actually more effective. So instead of attacking these people verbally, dragging them online, you know, saying hurtful, hateful, horrible things that could potentially put their mental health in danger, forgetting that behind that social media account, behind the face of that company, behind those words and those hateful actions is an actual human being with feelings and emotions and all of that, we become so angry, right, that we only participate in the witch hunt side of things, in the hurtful side of things. But we forget that when we log off, what is really going to cause a change is to actively not support that person with your money, right? And money talks. Money is powerful. Your dollars are very powerful and they mean something, because when you participate in non-support and you stop supporting that person with your money, that is actually going to make an effect that's big enough, and that is going to cause a reaction in that other person that is noticeable enough that will cause them to turn away from their current actions, to change, because it's hitting their pockets. And they're gonna realize, oh, you know, nobody's buying my stuff anymore. No one's going to my films anymore. I'm not being supported. My fans are dwindling. I need to change. I need to wake up. I need to do something different. Now, whether that change is genuine or not, that's a whole nother story and a whole nother discussion. And that's something that you have to decide for yourself. But that is actually something that's actively going to make a difference, as opposed to just this cancel culture online where there's nothing actively being done. And you know, when the next scandal breaks, that person kind of off the hook and it's like on to the next story and things kind of blow over and they were gonna continue to do what they were doing anyway and people are just gonna sweep it under the rug. So now when it comes to BookTube with cancel culture, I have seen this a lot on Book Twitter. You guys, Book Twitter is a trap. I am not on Book Twitter. When I become a published author, I will not be on Book Twitter. Sorry y'all, you guys are gonna have to connect with me another way. But a lot of authors are kind of exposing themselves on Book Twitter by their retweets, their tweets, the things that they're supporting, the things that they're saying. Like, it's so unfortunate. And I'm the kind of person where I believe in separating the artist from the art. I'm a very strong believer in that. Otherwise, I would never want to read like Alice in Wonderland. I would never support, you know, a lot of authors that I have a lot of respect for. And I mean respect because I respect their writing, I respect their craft, I respect the books that they've put out. You know, a lot of these classic authors that I really like their work, I would never read their work because of the person behind the work. So I'm a very firm believer in separating the art from the artist, if you can. Now, sometimes the artist and the character of the artist is so, like, their actions and their character is so overwhelmingly against you and against your soul and who you are that you cannot separate them and you can't ignore it. understandable. But for the most part, I am a believer in separating the two. So I say all that to say, book Twitter is a trap. And a lot of authors on book Twitter are really digging themselves into a hole that they're gonna be really struggling to get out of when it comes time to get people to buy their books. I know a lot of authors, you know, across all genres now that have been canceled by readers because of things that they've said, the things they've retweeted, things that they've liked. Just mess, you guys, just mess. And because of their actions online, they've now been canceled and they've lost, you know, a lot of, you know, loyal readers, loyal fans, and even potential new readers because of their actions. And these new readers are like, oh, I saw that tweet, I saw that like, I saw that dislike, I saw that retweet, I saw that photo on Instagram, I saw that blog post or that, you know, blog piece. I am not going to be supporting this author. I'm not going to be buying their next book. You know, I was curious about this book, but now I'm not going to buy it. So when it comes to cancel culture in the bookish community, I do feel that we are very quick to cancel these authors. Like, we waste no time. We're like, oh, what they said, what they liked, what they tweeted, what, oh, they're canceled, I'm not buying their books. You know, we go on these huge campaigns to cancel these people, and I just think that it might be a bit premature. I think we need to start to actively practice trying to separate the artist and the art a little bit more. Also, I feel like authors, y'all need to get off book Twitter if you can't stop getting yourself in trouble and stop getting yourself into these scandals. What happened to just being on social media to promote your books and just being chill and low-key? Instead, things get very, very personal and not in a good way. I understand wanting to connect with your fans, but some of the things that some of these authors are doing online is just like, you gotta have a divide, okay? You need to keep your personal life behind the scenes and understand that you are, you know, a recognizable name now, and whatever you do, people are going to connect that to your work. You know, like I said, I believe in separating art from artists, but most people don't, and most people don't know how to. And people like to support and buy things from people that they like. So when you become unlikable, it takes a permanent hit on your career and on your brand. And sometimes it's really hard to come back from that, you know, especially in the publishing. Publishing is a very hard industry. And if you make missteps, especially in the beginning of your career, it can have detrimental effects that can be very, very hard to recover from. So this is almost like a warning video for all writers out there. Just be very careful what you're tweeting, what you're doing online. You know, cancel culture is very real out here. And, you know, you guys are ruthless online. Like, you guys are really vicious. So I believe in non-support, and I believe in giving people second chances within reason, but this cancel culture thing has really just gotten out of hand. But anyways, that's all I wanted to say in this video. You guys let me know how you feel and what you think down below. Again, please try not to name any names out of disrespect. I don't want to start this like fuel and feud and fire online where we're name dropping and we're scandal dropping. Let's not do that. Just respectfully comment down below in generalizations and let me know your thoughts, and I will catch you guys in my next video. Bye, guys. Mwah.